Hey guys, is this thing on?
I'm sure I plugged it in. Is that plugged in over there?
Andy, is this thing on?
Check in. 1, 2.
Is this thing on?
Check. I have phantom power.
Welcome to Chicks with Gear, the podcast, where three lifelong friends get together to drink some coffee, play some music, talk about gear, and our quest for the most perfect acoustic sound on stage.
Yes.
I'm Deb.
I'm Julie.
I'm Andy.
He's not a chick. No, he's not. He's our resident gearhead, the fabulous Andy Most. Debbie. Who we got in the house today?
Well, today we have the awesome Chaz Williams.
Yes.
Back in Studio 3-0 to help us turn the tables on the fabulous Andy Most.
Oh.
Welcome, Chaz.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Turn the tables on the one with the most perfect acoustic sound on stage.
That's right.
Yes.
Enter. Kermit frightening gift right now.
Well, Chaz Williams was one of our first guests on our podcast. And after Chaz's interview, Julie and I were talking that we didn't realize how much history that you and Andy have. And we thought, how cool would it be to get Chaz back and turn the tables on Andy and he becomes our guest and we get to interview him.
I think it's brilliant.
Well, it was our idea. So.
Andy.
Yes, sir.
How's it going?
Oh, it's
good
going.
To be back. Thank y'all for having me back. Had a blast the last time, and this time, look forward to finding out what secrets Andy's got under the hood.
Me too. Yeah. Thank you, Jazz.
His guitar already sounds really great. Looking at Andy's amazing pedal board and see how that works.
I know.
Me too.
Because it sounds really good.
Yeah, it does.
I was looking at it earlier. He shooed me out of there.
Don't you worry about it.
That's because he's still working on it.
Shoot. Well, thank you, Chaz. Deb and I have been really looking forward to having you back so we can find out all of his secrets. So, Chaz, do you want to start the interrogation?
Of course.
Yes. Yes.
Me too.
This is frightening.
That's some good questions. All right.
Yeah.
Andy.
Yes, sir.
Went to 4 years of college at University of Miami studying music. And
could be longer.
Well, we'll say.
Off and on.
Right. And did some gigging. And before he moved up to Nashville, and just start with who some of your favorite guitar players were.
Okay.
And maybe who some of the guitar players we've heard of nowadays that also were in school at the same time you were, possibly.
Oh.
Well, let's see. So, pre-University of Miami. You know, you got your Beatles, and you got your Grand Funk, you got your Led Zeppelin, Deep Purple, then up to Yes, then Humble Pie, all of them. Then sort of got into Mahavishnu Orchestra and fusion.
How old are we here when we're listening to all this music?
We are like...
10.
13 to 17, 18.
Formative years.
Yeah. So then I had to go to school. And so I went to the University of Miami and was like a liberal arts major for a year. And that was horrible. And so I was like, all right, I got to figure out how to get in the music school. And so I got in eventually. So one night, Friday night, after doing things you probably shouldn't be doing, we went over to the Rathskeller and I walked in and there was this band playing the University of Miami Rock Ensemble. And they played like an Allman Brothers song and then a Mahavishnu Vishnu Orchestra song. And then the lights went off. And I was like, what just happened? So I went back the next night, caught the whole thing. So anyway, this is the pre-Dixie Dregs. And I was like an unbelievable fan.
Steve Morse.
So they graduated. He graduated like the year I got there. But I was like, I don't even think I was a music major yet. I don't remember. I was like, oh my God, if this is what happens, I got to get into this program. You know, not knowing, but realizing that really this only happens to like amazing people that actually are like super incredibly talented and practice forever. So.
So are we playing acoustic guitar now? Are we playing electric guitar? Where are we?
When I got to the University of Miami, first year I started music school, I had a Martin D35, which is weird because it was a studio music and jazz was actually what the major was called. And so then I got like a jazz guitar thinking that would make me a jazz guitar player, which it didn't. But anyway. So, yeah. So, and then Pat Metheny was there a couple of years before I was there. They kept talking about him. I had no idea who that was, but then I went through.
That's cool.
Serious phase. So I'm like, I'd like to say like Coltrane and Miles are my biggest influences, but they're not. But they are influences, but you know, I'm definitely guitar centric. I love all the guitar heroes like everybody else, man.
Yeah. So is there a jazz guitarist that you absolutely love?
Yeah, Metheny. I mean, you know, listen to Wes Montgomery. I sound nothing like him, but I definitely did a lot of trying to transcribe solos.
Who do you like that plays maybe more acoustic stuff?
Let's see. When I had the Martin D35, I went through a Leo Kottke phase. Sound nothing like him, but I was totally into that. Greenhouse, great album. Love Steve Morse's acoustic playing. Love Pat Metheny's acoustic playing. Love Tony Rice's acoustic playing. Christopher Parkinney, although classical.
Cited a bunch of rock influences, and then you were studying jazz and obviously hearing a bunch of the great jazz guitar players. But I don't know how many people know you play classical guitar really well.
Yes.
So,
were you
doing that at the time too, down there learning sore pieces and things?
So, at the University of Miami, the jazz program at the time, I'm sure they don't do this anymore because it was like ridiculous. You had to take 2 years of classical guitar before you could take private jazz lessons, which is weird.
That is weird.
Yeah. So,
but good.
Everybody just trying to get through it. And I like the music. So, but since I've been there, I'll play like 3 months at a time. And I'm like, all right, I'm going to get good at classical. And then I give it up for the rest of the year. And it's been going on every single year.
That's why you're so great.
Oh, yeah.
What made you gravitate to the guitar? I mean, I saw a guy at some party in high school playing guitar, and I was like, wow, I didn't know you could do that. And I don't know, what about you? Did you see some players back when you were in high school or pre-high school?
I think where people say they remember when they were 3 years old. I'm not saying I was three, but I don't remember. But I do remember like seeing the Beatles. And so I've walked around with a tennis racket like it was a guitar.
Are there pictures?
I hope not. High school. I mean, we were at Battle of the Bands. There were some great bands, and I've followed them everywhere, any Battle of the Bands they were in. And love so that. There were, let's see.
What was your first gear ever? Did you have, I think I saw a picture of you with a Les Paul at one time. When you're in high school.
Yeah. My first guitar was a Hagstrom 3. And then I remember my mother, she bought me a Gibson SG. And I remember plugging that into the amp I had.
Which
I think like a basement head. Not anything exotic.
Wish you still had, though.
Yeah, no kidding. Yeah. It was overdriven. I was like, "That, where did that sound come from?" And this was like humbucking pickups. I didn't know what anything was. So then let's see, Ralph Agresta, who's a great guitar player, local guitar player. I think he had a gold top Les Paul. And so I had to have that. So I got that. I had that. But at first I had an Epiphone Les Paul Custom. Uh-huh. And then probably that picture of Battle of the Bands, probably playing Stairway to Heaven, was a gold top.
Yeah.
Deluxe, probably.
Yeah. Deluxe. How's that? Deluxe.
Yeah. Yeah, nice.
So I do remember, Andy, you showing us a picture of you singing when you were younger. Was that a real picture? Were you ever singing in a band at any point?
So me and James and Carl, shout out to James and Carl.
We're
playing in James's basement.
Right.
I actually was singing. That's not a picture you saw, but I sung "I'm a Man" by Chicago.
Oh.
Nah, it's pretty horrible, man. So, okay. Anyway,
No singing.
What was your first effects pedal? What, did you have anything at that point, like a fuzz or?
Face shifter. So I think I said this before. I think my mother told me if I learned the song Something by the Beatles, she'd buy me a wah-wah pedal. But yes. I had a Univox Super Fuzz, I guess, like orange and blue. Yeah, that was the first one I remember.
Yeah.
That's funky.
Yeah, I had a wah-wah too. Very first, first fiddle I ever had was a phase shifter.
Oh. Right.
Then got a wah-wah. Had to have that, you know.
Definitely.
When did wah-wah pedals come into play into music?
Well, I mean, I would say Hendrix, but I'm sure there's people using it before that.
That's what I would say, too. That's the first.
Popularized it, for sure.
That's the first I heard one, I believe.
With Hendrix.
Jimi Hendrix, ever hear of him, Deb?
I absolutely have. I saw that movie, Back to the Future. That's how I know about Hendrix.
And then there was Shaft.
Oh, right.
Shaft. Right?
And I was like, whoa, what is that, you know?
Oh,
yeah.
The movie.
Oh, yeah. The movie.
Guys, yeah. Yes. Actually,
yeah, the theme song for Chad. So, Andy, you were studying jazz in studio in school. What turned out to be different when you got out of school and started playing gigs?
Good question.
Different than you expected it to be?
Trying to support yourself.
So, that's very different.
There was some help along the way, though. I'm not saying that. So after I got out of school, I was just looking to try to work playing music, which, as we all know, it's not. It comes easier for some people than others. So I think I was a stock boy at a Jordan Marsh at a department store.
Oh, Jordan Marsh.
I remember Jordan Marsh.
Shout out to George Marsh.
I wanted to, I thought playing on a cruise ship would be like it. And so they actually had agents back then. And eventually the guy called and there was an opening. And so I went and I auditioned while the ship was in port on a Saturday. And as I was going on to do it, the guy leaving was a guitar player I knew from the University of Miami.
Oh, wow.
He was done. He had enough. He was like, oh, man, you got this. And so I got that. And I did that for about 6 months.
Was that then, country music?
No, the country of Colombia. Because the band I played with were all Colombians and like spoke hardly any English.
Oh, cool.
But it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, Latin. Did you, had any experience playing Latin music before?
Is that no, you know, trying to find one was always a lot of fun.
Latin we didn't sambas? Play that.
There were a bunch of sambas, but a lot of it was just regular, great American. Song books though. So
Girl from Ipanema.
Yes. And so when that finally ended though, the very first week, because that's the only time I could save any money because there was nothing to spend it on. And so the first week I bought an MXR flanger doubler and a pedal steel.
And a pedal steel? Really? I thought that was a joke.
No.
Oh, my.
Oh, yeah. My whole thing was I wanted to be able to you know, gig on it. And lots I could never get past. You know, it's about, although I got another one at Emmons because I was like, all right, I got to learn to play C6, but I couldn't even get past the other thing. So.
No bueno.
Are there pictures of that?
Yeah, there's a picture somewhere of pedal steel. Yeah.
Magic.
So, and then I worked in some clubs down there, like 3 years, a house band in Homestead playing country. And I just decided I got to see if there's something else. And LA, you know, horrible reader of music. Well, I can write it and read a little bit, but that kind of scared me off. And so I was like, all right, Nashville, this number system thing, really. So I hit it up here. Yeah. But back to the University of Miami. So I was there as a liberal arts major and just bombing out of school. And then I walked into a club and saw a band, which is now the Dixie Dregs, and they were students there. And I was like,
wow,
I was just hooked because that was major influence. And even though I just learned a lot from trying to transcribe their stuff. Yeah. Yeah, no, they turned my, I just couldn't believe it. I was like, you know, here was a bunch of these rocking kind of guys that were obviously much more than that.
Yeah,
and,
right.
We were crazy. We just followed them all over the place. And we're like, why don't you guys have a deal? What is, you know? Yeah. We called, when they got their deal on Capricorn, I remember we went down to a phone booth and at the apartment I was living in, we called Capricorn. What's up with them? And they were out actually in LA recording their first album. I mean, we were just like crazy.
Your fans?
That's cool. Yeah,
fanatical.
That's so awesome. Now, were you still in school when they got their record deal or had you moved up to Nashville?
I was in school.
Oh, you're still in school?
Huh? Yeah. Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
So do you have a favorite song from the Dixie Dregs?
Wow. What a question.
I can't pick one.
I can't pick one.
Oh, come on. What was the hardest one to transcribe?
Night Meets Light.
Okay.
So they always would have like, this, I think I read a review of it, like chrome plated. They always had like some super very involved country-ish kind of song with an incredible harmony and just unbelievable parts. Actually, there's a video of Sierra Hull playing fun of it, Pride of the Farm. And then they would always have this very kind of slow orchestral, you know, symphonic, actually chamber music kind of song with the solo over. The thing about them was, even though it was fusion music, you know, fusion, sorry. You know, a lot of that stuff has these really long solos and it's like, it's very boring. I'm bored with it. But their stuff always changed. Their solos were short, very melodic to me. And so that's what kind of hooked me on it. It sounded commercial, even though it's like something you would not hear on the radio.
Hey, when you say you transcribed solos, do you mean you actually wrote it out on staff paper or did you just learn it on the guitar?
Yeah, some. No, I actually wrote Night Meets Light out. We played that once because I had a fusion band down there. I didn't have one. I played with some people. We had a country band, New Country. Shout out to Debbie Spring.
Ooh, yeah.
Unbelievable. One of the best musicians. Viola, fiddle, mainly viola though. But
nice.
Yeah.
Have you run across her up in Nashville?
She was actually in the Mavericks. They got their deal.
Yeah,
I remember that.
Yeah.
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 I thought you were going to say something else.
This is a whole lot of me, man.
Well, but that's, you're the guest.
All right, okay.
Yeah.
A lot of me.
So, Andy, what was it? Pull the trigger to make you want to jump in a car and drive up to Nashville.
Yeah.
And part B of that question, who did you know up here? Did you go stay on somebody's floor or couch something, which most of us do. But.
Right. Well, I was gigging with Frank and Vivian down at the Leisure Lounge, like 6 nights a week, sometimes 7 when this other guy would come for like 3 years. And these were late nights, man. This was like 9 to 2 or something, I think. 9 to 1, 2 on the weekends. And so, you know, definitely not a big fish, but bigger fish, you know, and a small, you know, I thought, all right, there's got to be something else besides this. It was either LA or Nashville, and LA kind of scared me in general, just from, you know,
so big.
Not being a great reader of music and not having any idea about any of it. And New York, well, I was from New York, but I wouldn't know what to do there. And I thought, okay, Nashville, Nashville Number System. Yay, I think I can do this. Yes.
Yeah.
So
15-11.
Came up here on my honeymoon.
Oh, wow.
Because there was money to go somewhere. So we came up here.
Oh, I love that.
And Suzanne's aunt and uncle actually lived here, like, since World War II.
No way. Oh, wow.
Yeah. So that's really cool. Stayed there, and she, I won't go into Wheezy.
Wheezy.
Wheezy. Aww. Rest in peace, Wheezy. But Wheezy, if you, you know, like, there was this show, what was it called? Was it not New Country? TV taping down at the cannery. You walk in with her. She'll take you to the front row past everybody. I mean, no matter where, man.
It's magic.
So I think we stayed there, and then like a year later, moved up here. And well, during that week, honeymoon, brought my telly up and met Joe Glazer over on De Munbrand to put a string bender in. He did it in a week, which would never, ever, ever happen again. Except now they're like knocking them out after a couple of days. But there was a period of time where you'd probably wait a year to get it. So that was cool. And so then I went to some clubs, and I looked, and I checked out guitar players. I was like, I think I can do this. So moved up here a year later and sat for about a year not doing anything, just trying to do any gigs I could. But the first week I was here, I saw Brent Moyer's name, and I think we discussed this already. Yeah, that's how I met you.
Right.
So didn't really know anybody here.
It was magical.
It was magical. We're still here.
Yes. Yes.
So Andy, once you got here and kind of got your established in town, what was some of the first auditions you ever did? And what was that like? I mean, what kind of gear did you take to the auditions? And
well, I'm sure, I can't remember what it was, but I'm sure I didn't get the gig. I'm about 50% on this. When I got to town, and you know, stereo was like the thing, and so I remember going to the, not the Rose Room, Stagecoach. Don Kelly always had amazing guitar players. I mean, right, Brent Mason. That's before I got here. But Danny Parks was playing, and I thought his sound was killer, which was kind of a stereo direct kind of sound. People were playing through monitor. I don't even know what his rig was back then, but I loved that sound, so I had to pursue that. So I think I went over to Tusculum Music, where they'd let you walk and make payments, and got like a PV special for I had a Mesa Boogie with me. That's the amp I had. So that was my rig for a while, the two amps with.
So the PV special being influenced by Brent Mason, because he played PV.
No, time, just an affordable second amp, I think, was it. Right.
And there's that.
So, but I remember, you know, if you came up here, you were always, if you were auditioning for something, you were trying to learn Brent Mason licks.
Yeah.
You had to play. Right.
I didn't go to the Stagecoach much, but we used to hang out at the Rose Room.
Right.
And on Thursday night was Pickers night. And because Bobby Witten played guitar at Opryland.
Probably was there while you were
Yes. And so he would let us get up and sing, but it was so awesome because all the guys off the road would come in and sit in.
Yeah.
And you get to hear everybody that was, you know, big stuff back then. And we loved it.
Right.
Yes.
Remember Gabe's Jazz? Gabe's,
I do. I got a gig there once.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was, this guy had a gig in Colorado for like 2 weeks, needed a bass player. So yeah, I play bass, and I had a bass. I'd never played bass in a band in my life. But so anyway, I, you know, drove out to Paris, Tennessee one morning with my bass and got in their van, took off to Colorado for 2 weeks.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So they hated my bass playing. It was like the longest 2 weeks for them, but man, I was having a blast. You
know? I want more of this.
actually tried to learn how to sing on the road again and play bass at the same time, and it was really difficult.
Wow. I'd
say so.
I played bass on a cruise ship for 2 weeks because it was a Holland American cruise ship, and they needed a bass player, and horrible, horrible bass player. And I'm pretty sure they hated me, but they had a talent show like one night. It wasn't necessarily for the band, but I got up and played like Sweet Georgia Brown, and then there were people who were like,
Wait.
Guitar. Yeah. So yeah, terrible bass player. Gabe's had this thing. You'd sit in and there was like an order to when you would fill or something. I mean, they always, if you were on the left, this is probably not exactly right. You had to go in this order, whose turn it was, whether it was still. And if you got out of order, you would definitely get the eye. I hated that place, man, but
losers.
I couldn't play those tunes anyway, so.
Yeah, it seemed like there was a lot of more of those kind of places.
And then one cool thing, you might have, like Phil Baugh, you know, like unbelievable guitar player. He had a bar, his own personal bar on his property. I don't know where it was, like Dixon or something, got called to go out there. Not necessarily by him, but I was like, wow, I can't believe I'm playing at Phil Baugh's, you know. This is like, if Amy Lou called to have you come sing somewhere at her inner
backyard.
Sorry. I don't know. Not like that, but Phil Baugh is like unbelievable. I'm like, what am I doing? And he just wanted people playing at his place.
Oh, wow.
That was kind of cool. Did that a couple of times.
Cool. Is that with a band that was already established out there that you were subbing for?
I don't know. What was the guy's name? Kirby or something. You probably know this guy. He was a drummer. I can't remember who was out there. Auditions. Let's see.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody's favorite thing.
Alan Tilton. Sorry. This was this guy we played this with, Aaron Tippin, and this like 95-year-old guy introduced him. Ladies and gentlemen, Alan Tilton. And so that always stuck. Yeah. So audition, that was like the first good gig.
Yeah.
And I got it. They started rehearsals and I wanted like to tie my shoes and I could not get off the floor. My back was gone. They took me out on a stretcher and I thought, oh man. Exactly. Hasn't happened since. But I thought the rehearsals start. I had to have the road manager came over, grabbed my gear, took it over there, went to the hospital, and you know, they didn't fire me. Not then. They didn't. So
what a way to go get your own roadie, Andy. That was a pretty
Yeah, I know, right? That was over on Priest Lake, Chaz.
I remember that very well. Andy called me. Said, hey, Chaz, can you come over and give me a hand? He was laying on the floor between his bed and the wall.
Oh, wow.
And couldn't get up. I said, man, let me help you up. And I tried to help him up, and it hurt so bad. He said, no, man.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, anyway, that was Priest Lake area. Back to the
yes, sir.
Tipping audition, if you don't mind. I'm just curious how you heard about it. First of all, was there internet? Did you have internet at the time to learn material, or did you have to get cassettes? Did they give you a cassette to learn some songs off of for the audition?
That's a good question, man. CDs?
CDs?
Yeah, CDs. How did I hear about it? I don't know. I'm going to find that guy, though, whoever it was. We need to talk.
Were there several guitar players there ahead of you and stuff like that?
Yeah. Well, I won't say any of their names. Please. I don't remember. I remember one. A friend, actually. Yeah, I don't know. I guess I just, there was a callback for it and got it. I was like,
yeah,
it was like
that's a celebration there.
Yeah.
Yes.
First audition success.
Yeah. It's like being in the military in kindergarten at the same time, you know, on the road. Anyway, you know all about it. Not with but
right. Yes.
Yeah.
That was good. I thought, all right, finally.
So Andy.
There you are. I wondered where you were.
I'm here. So obviously you've had this like long journey, learning instruments, traveling, trying to figure out your sound.
Yes.
And you know, we've known you a long time. So obviously your style of playing, you've got influences of jazz and blues and country and classical. And yet you love pedal boards and gear. I would love to know what got you kind of in that mindset. Was it because you were playing acoustic and you just wanted more sounds, or was there something else?
Well, so reality, I actually got over the gear thing. Yeah, right. People are saying, yeah, right. A little bit. No. And you girls brought me back into it. So, true story.
That's kind of funny. I was just going to say on that note, let's get to the nitty gritty.
Let's do it.
Let's talk gear.
What you worry about?
Ooh, wow. Look at that. Ooh, that's amazing.
Don't you worry about it. Right.
Yeah. Wow.
Is that cat air?
That's Bob.
Yes,
Bob
is.
Likes the pedal board.
It adds to the tone, Andy told me.
Chaz will start sneezing in about a second. Eyes watering.
Too close on it.
Oh, no. I like how you still have your protector right there. Yes, on there. That's very nice.
Thank you.
Do we use these?
Yeah.
Yes, we do. I know you do. I'm just teasing. Well, I thought maybe there would be misdirection.
Yeah. You don't know what order they're in.
Well, let's talk about them.
Yes.
We can do it.
Yeah. I see you've got your power supply underneath here. Mm-hmm. That's nice.
That would be your Voodoo Labs 4x4.
Yeah. Oh. So you get to the gig, you plug in here into the wall.
Yes, sir.
And then your line 6 pedal doesn't have any... have a cord.
Don't you worry about
you plug
it.
That in.
So,
I guess that comes
so
later.
That, so that... All right. So that line 6... great piece of gear, world's dumbest power supply ever made. Oh. So it can't be powered by anything. There's probably something, but you got to plug it in. It's a huge power supply. And that it's heavy and it goes underneath. And it's not under there right now, but it would be. Yes. It has been. It's just not right now, but that would go underneath. Yeah.
Yes.
Love the looper on that. So that stays.
A looper.
Yeah.
So what's the first thing your guitar sees when you plug in?
First thing my guitar sees is the Grace Design Alex preamp.
That's
we love Grace.
Down there in that corner, I can't really see.
Great EQ, and has a great DI out, and has a boost. Boost is nice.
You like boost is good.
And a mute. Mute is good.
Mute is very good.
If you see anybody over on that side, tell them mute is good. So
there you go. Good. Oh, burn.
No, no, no. You got the big girl there, the Felix.
I do. Felix the cat.
Yeah. See, there's a theme.
There
here.
You go. There is a theme.
So there's a tuner out that's going to that prehistoric Boss tuner over on in front of it. And what am I doing? Let's see.
What's the little one?
That is a tap tempo for the Keeley Halo, which is on top, which is a delay. And so you can tap in, you know, if you want to be close to in time with something. The Keeley is cool. Robert Keeley, he's a cool guy. He's been nice to me. And so that is a digital delay, and it's got, so great guitar player, Andy Timmons, you might know, he has this kind of not signature thing, but it's a delay sound where it's a quarter note, tapped quarter note, and dotted eighth at the same time. Anyway, so they designed that after him that does that. There's plenty of stuff that does that, but this is tweaks for that. Yeah.
Yes.
So it's got two it has four presets, but two are accessible right away. So I got that on one side. Then on the right side, I have like a short delay with modulation.
Oh, so the two switches are presets.
Exactly. Ah. Hopefully, once in a while, it goes back to nothing. I don't know what it's doing, but so far,
user error.
Yeah. Well, there's plenty of that. Yeah.
Like, do you hit them both together to program it or memorize?
This is a good question. I think one of those knobs you hold down, I forget which one I'm not looking at, save it. There's four that you can store in there, but I only got two because, like, you know, that's a pain going in there and trying to.
Right. Is there a way to tell which preset you're on? Is there a light up or something?
Yeah. I think there's four little LEDs on the bottom that tells you which.
Cool.
I think.
Mm. So from there, you're going. Preamping, is this in an effects loop or is it straight out of the preamp?
It's not. Once in a while. So the Alex has an effects loop, which is great to put all the stuff in there because then you could use the DI that's on the Alex if you want all your effects in it. And so I do that once in a while, but most of the time I'm just coming out of the Alex and the DI is going after everything. So going into the Keeley, then into the timeline, scribing timeline, which, has been around forever. And I was like 10 years too late getting it. I needed to see what that was about.
The Strymon, we like
it. And is that all delays and modulations?
It is. I mean, there's like two, but the Keeley is just a little more, I don't know.
Specific.
Analog, maybe. It's a little more syrupier. I don't know if that's true. Yeah. It sounds a little different.
Good description.
Yeah, but the timeline has this really great reverb in it called Verbi, like too much. You'd never use it on anything. And so I use that. And so
he uses Verbi.
But then next to that, you got the other Strymon Blue Sky, which is reverb. So it's kind of killer. I mean, not killer's not the word. Overkill is what I mean.
Overkill.
How much reverb?
Really killer? Overkiller.
And so then it goes into that line six, which has great tremolo, it's got delays and stuff, but I like the looper in it.
And what do you use the looper for, Andy?
Sometimes I try to set up a little loop on the intro of a song. Certain songs that you guys do.
Oh, yeah.
But then the whole thing,
so you got a loop for an intro of a Sister's Way revival song.
Yes.
What if the tempo isn't exactly what the loop is set at?
That never happens.
No, never.
Can you adjust it? Is just a tap tempo for the
I would loop? Just bail on it. So, and usually I might do it just for like an intro of something. And then once the song starts, I might get out of it. If it's just... Mm-hmm.
And we're not in when he's doing that. We're like out.
You could be, but we don't, we don't practice it enough. And then this whole thing, it's kind of ridiculous because it really sounds great in stereo. But I mean, how often are you playing in stereo acoustic? Not often, but once in a while I bring two amps. And so.
Yes.
It's just chicks with gear.
We like the two amps.
They like stuff.
We like the stuff.
I like the stuff. You know, it's
really.
We have
to experiment. He usually gets there first. Yes. Before we do, and then I like he sets all up, and then I'm like, hey, what is that over there? Yeah, I don't remember that last week.
So
super hypocrite here too.
Yeah. Why?
I admit it because I'm like, if I heard someone with that stuff, I go, man, you got too much of that. You got too much. Yet I do it. So you know,
save it for Andy. Yeah. Don't you do that? Don't you worry about it.
And the slap. So I use the slap a lot. Just kind of fattens up the.
I like the slap too.
It's the loop you have set is Can't Find My Way Home, a song that you use that on?
It may or may not be. Yes.
Directly, maybe.
Yes.
And it sounds really cool.
Good guess.
Because, you got some great guitar parts going at the beginning of that record.
Thank you.
Yes, he does.
I concur.
Which you can find on Spotify.com.
Yes. And Amazon.
It's important.
And YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Apple Music.
That's right.
Even if you're keeping track at home.
Yes. You too.
That's right.
So tell us about why you chose these. If you don't mind.
I, I can do it. Well, so the Grace design just has amazing reputation, so I had to see what that was about. Same with Strymon. Like I say, I was way too late getting to it. Everybody had one. I had to have one.
Yes.
10 years later. Same with the Blue Sky and all this stuff. You will find it's like Logic versus Pro Tools, Republicans, Democrats. They will, you know, some people hate some of this stuff. Yeah. Some people, you know, I've had other stuff that I think sounds as good, but this seems to be working right now.
Yeah. Well, and that's one of the things we asked Chaz this, you know, so much gear changes over the years. Yeah. And so, you know, used to have all the racks of stuff
right.
with your electric guitar. Like, what is some of this because you liked that and now they just make a better sound? Or
it's a good question. It's all ridiculous. Well, I don't know now, but you had all the rack gear and then people are like, oh, that's too whatever, too sterile sounding, too whatever. So you go pedals and you have all these pedals and you're still trying to make it sound like a rack.
So. That's a rack. There's a reason we all like that, right?
But
which is to make it all sound like just a guitar to going straight into an amp.
Yeah. And that's right.
Yes. Exactly. And then there's that.
And that's gone.
Yeah.
We're trying.
But, you know, I will say, you know, I struggle with that with my little amp and I love the amp that we have, but it needs that because it just doesn't sound, live, like the way it sounds in a room. You know, we'd all sing in the bathrooms when we were on the road because
we didn't in the bathrooms Andy. No, we didn't.
Yes, we did.
He couldn't be in the girl bathroom.
Well, it was like a shower room. We all went in there.
Yes.
Right. A unisex shower.
A unisex shower.
Just trying to make sure people are not thinking we like literally
no one else was in there.
I know.
Where was I? I don't remember any of this.
Yes, you were. Because we'd all go in there and just play because of the acoustics.
Yes. But it wasn't where the toilets were and there were no other ladies and Andy was in there. To be clear.
It was in our dressing area. And so we would
One bathroom was like super nice. So.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The bidet.
Yeah. You are psycho-ick, man. I was going to do it, but I didn't.
So this knob here is, that's like shower door open and shower door closed.
Yes. The better acoustic sound.
Yeah. Better.
Hey, you know what we need to talk about?
What?
Is your guitar pickup.
Oh, yeah.
And the cables you use.
Yes. Ooh.
Yes. Right.
Yeah. Cables are very important. They need to be going the right direction. I do not subscribe to that. But let's see. Guitar pickup. I have an Anthem SL. Lots of people hate that.
They do.
What is that?
That is bags. Yeah. Goes underneath the saddle. So there's a whole thing that's that mess with your tone, which I can see, you know, sticking something under the saddle doesn't sound great. But, this thing just works.
Yes,
and it
does.
Always works. And so I don't fight that fight on forums. It's a big fight, though.
Yeah.
It just
You'll
works.
Do you. I'll do me.
Does your guitar have a built-in preamp before it gets to the outlet?
It does have a preamp, I guess, on the end pin on this.
Well, tell them what guitar you play.
This would be your Collings OM2H.
Beautiful.
Coveted that thing and then finally got one. It's been great. Very consistent.
Sounds amazing.
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And so the Anthem.
So on a previous episode, we did talk about our amps, but people may not have had a chance to listen to that episode. Would you like to share what amp you use on stage with your Collings?
I can do it.
And this pedal board?
This is going all through a Fishman artist.
Yes.
Loud box. And he's still here.
He likes those amps.
Yeah.
He does.
So going through the Fishman amp. We all have them.
Yes, we do.
So the Fishman artist loud box, loud box artist.
Pickle Becker over there.
So yeah, it's all going through a Fishman loud box artist on stage. If I got the order of that right.
Yes.
Because we've played a bunch of smaller little clubs, and it's great to get your sound on stage, not having to rely through somebody else's monitors.
Yes.
Kind of thing. We like that.
Yes, we do.
Kind of control. Self-contained. Yes. Yeah, control is good.
Control is good.
And I have a Bose, whatever that is, like yours.
Yeah. PAs have come a long way. They look crazy now and easy to carry.
Yeah, they sound great.
They do sound great.
You don't need five of us to carry in a bass bin anymore. It looks kind of like a little sailboat with a long mast, that's it.
Yeah, I needed to know how to use yours, so I bought one myself.
True story.
Yeah.
True that.
But it's great. I love having it.
Yeah. So.
Would you ever skip the Fishman amp and go straight into
the PA? I thought of bringing that, and because it's, it has like the spacer in the middle and then the speakers up top, which sounds great. But like if you're playing a club, I lost the spacer. So it would be just like an amp. It just didn't sound the same. And I thought, well, the guy where we were playing, he has a Bose. And I thought if I showed up with another Bose PA system, that might be a little weird. But
I wanted to.
I didn't do it. Yeah.
Don't be offended. We're bringing another one.
Yeah.
But ours sounds better for some reason.
But back in the day with Jennifer McCarter and the McCarters, I had these little Bose and I thought, this is it. I'm bringing this on the road for acoustic guitar. And I brought them out and it was horrible.
Oh,
so
no.
I stopped doing that.
Oh,
yeah,
there it is.
Exactly.
It didn't go the first time.
Oh,
so what did you have for preamps and gear on the floor with the McCarters?
Well, what did I have? I had to have like a TC Electronics parametric EQ and more rack stuff.
Were you playing electric then or acoustic or both?
I was playing acoustic, but here's a great, well, I don't know if it's a great story, but it's a story. Our buddy Jeff King.
Yes.
I was playing on Nashville Now. We would all do this thing like tone check after you take a break, call up, tone check, how was it? And so I had this piece of gear, which I taught a reverb unit. And I don't know if I had two channels. One was out of phase, but the actual sound that went through to the TV feed was 100% reverb, no dry, after I played the song. So I called Jeff and he let me know.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Dang it.
Gear bad.
Well, that is the trick, right? You know, technology, it's great till it's not.
Tone check was a good phone call if you had another song.
I think we did have another one.
That's you good. Did.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was any better, but Yep. So, and I was borrowing Dave France's guitar when I got that job because I didn't have an acoustic. So he lent me a nice guild he had. And I proceeded to walk into a table at a Holiday Inn on the corner of it and I stand in it.
Not good.
But Dave, so cool. He didn't care. I'm sure he did care, but he's always acted like he didn't care.
Oh, no problem.
Very good. Yeah.
No problem. Yeah.
So, Andy, you got a...
Yes, sir.
Do you have more electric guitars at home or more acoustic guitars?
Ooh, good question.
Well, I currently have 4 classical guitars.
Ooh.
So this is like that 3-month phase that I was telling you about.
Right.
Ooh. I always get them with... I'm going to check them out and then like send back the one I don't want. And then time runs out and I still have it. So, which is currently happening right now. I just got one yesterday.
What'd you get?
This would be your Cordoba GK Studio. It's a nice guitar. I was just looking for an easy playing guitar, not too expensive that you can plug in. And so far this is working, but how many times have you heard me say that only to tell you?
A lot.
I chucked it.
Yeah. Oh. So it's not even going to make it to the check it or keep it. Somewhere.
No, I think this one's staying.
But oh.
I got the other one that I got to worry about checking before time runs out.
Oh. Better get on it.
A couple of Telecasters, Strats. stock is lower right now, but
so you got a Collins, you got a Martin too, right?
I did have a Martin.
Is it a triple O?
No, I had a D18 for a while, and I've got this Ibanez, which I know that doesn't sound great, but it's really a nice guitar. I played it a few. I put a Sunrise pickup in that.
I brought that out before. Right? You had a Bougie.
Bourgeois.
Yes.
I did.
So when you
no longer have the Bourgeois?
Don't you worry about it.
So Andy, when
some bad choices.
Yeah, soon to have a Gallagher maybe?
No, but I played a beautiful 12 fret.
Oh yeah.
Gallagher over it. Gallagher.
Guitar.
Oh, it's beautiful. Company.
So Andy, when you go down into your guitar lair.
Yes.
Which is the one you grab? Like, well, you're like, I want to have a great day, so I'm going to pick this one. Or is it just automatic one you go to? Which would that be?
Well,
depends what the 3 month phase we're in.
Yeah, it would be the Tele or the Collings right now.
Okay.
So that's staying. But since we started the podcast,
yes,
there's another layer upstairs that came out of nowhere.
Hey guys, is this thing on?
A bunch of that stuff's living upstairs now.
I see. I get you. So you have two layers.
I do, and they're both immaculate right now.
Oh.
All right. I made that part up. You shouldn't see downstairs.
Got to keep Bob out of there.
Man. Well, this is my instrument lair here, the studio.
Yes.
Yes.
And now it's the podcast lair also.
Yes.
Yeah. I thought you were saying layer.
Layer. Like L-A-Y.
Layers of guitar.
Layers and layers.
Yeah.
Layer.
Like Batman.
So what current guitar amps are you using these days?
I've got a Christensen. A good friend of mine, ooh, Dave Christensen, hand built it. It's like a Tweed Deluxe, only bigger transformer and stuff.
Wow.
It's nice. Great. That's what I'm using.
That's it?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love that amp. Yay, Dave.
Yeah, I bet.
We don't see it, though, ever.
Do you ever lend it out?
No. He has. He's always trying to do stuff to it. He's always like, you got to let me put this negative feedback loop in. No. You need to put this thing on it. No. Can you build? And then I'll be, can you put a standby switch on it? No. But like a whole lot of no on it, man.
There's lots of no's.
Yeah.
I don't think I like the no's.
No no's.
Yeah.
So I have a question for you.
Yes.
If the world was aligning perfectly and you could have any guitar on the planet, is it not what's in your lair, or is there one out there you're like, if I could only have this one, I would be like the happiest guitar player in the world? And maybe you already are the happiest guitar player in the world.
I'm not the happiest guitar player in the world.
I'm happy though.
Yeah. You know, there is that whole thing. Like if I only had that, that would make it. If I only had this, you know, that piece of gear. So that's just a guitar player thing. Maybe not all of them, but that is definitely a thing.
So maybe I should have asked it differently.
No, I was going to answer it.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. Good.
I don't know. Some kind of vintage Martin guitar, vintage Gibson. Jazz guitar would be sweet.
Yes.
Vintage Fender Stratton, you know, vintage stuff. But
vintage, yeah. That's it? Okay. Well, that was a good answer.
Yeah.
I was just curious.
Yes.
Yes.
Vintage Marshall, vintage Fender.
Mm-hmm. There's a long list.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Don't you worry about it.
Yeah. Don't you guys worry about any of that.
Yeah. So Chaz is, we're back to Chaz now.
Yeah,
so back when he had, when I first moved to town, he had his, you know, two amp setup, or it might have been that ADA preamp or something, but
yeah,
he had volume pedals. Those were like real big. And the way his was set up, from what I remember, you had like a ton of gain on yours, right? If you stepped on it all the way, that was like, no, most people, not most, some people have it. All the way down, that's your max, you know, and you're that's where you go. But Chaz, if you went all the way down, you were blistering. So he had a certain style of how to use it, which he did fantastically. But it was,
yeah, people that would sit in, I'd try to explain it to them that you don't want to go past halfway.
Easy.
But that's, it doesn't take all the time. But yeah, that was, you know, going for the ability to do pedal steel swells. Yeah. We all love pedal steel, you know. So simulated swelling.
Are people using pedal steel more on records these days or less? Do you know? Is it popular still to use pedal steel? It seemed like every record when I first moved to town had pedal steel on it.
Yeah, and a banjo loop.
So. I'd say not as much. Yeah. That would be my impression.
I would say not as much.
I would say not as much. And
if so, it'd be back in the background, probably
like a padding.
Something. But not featured so much as it used to be.
You don't really see somebody playing it live either very often, or at least I don't. I mean, I don't go to a lot of shows to know that, so I should be, I'm speaking out of turn. I don't even know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, well, similar. That would mean listening to country music radio.
Yeah, which I don't.
So I don't. I'm not sure.
So maybe terrible. That was a bad question.
But the great pedal steel players are certainly doing sessions all the time. Yeah. And working a lot. So.
Okay. So there you go.
Nobody asks this, but there are amazing players in this town. That's all there I are. Have to say. Oh, so, you know, those that are getting it.
This has become the definitely melting pot for musicians to come and singers and songwriters.
I feel like before, I mean, I sound like the little old lady in the room, but like before you, there were more venues to get out and see some of these fabulous road guys and girls, and session players would get out and they'd play. I mean, even when we were playing at Tootsie's, somebody would say, oh, so-and-so's playing over at Legends. Right. And we'd all run down there to hear them sit in with somebody. And I mean, I don't hang out downtown, but that's not my impression of that. And like when we were play Tootsie, some of the people would come through and want to jump in and play with us. And it just, that's not my impression anymore. Yeah. And I miss that.
Somebody, they just sent me a thing. It was an article. I think it was a YouTuber about a player here who was talking about, I don't know what it's like, you know, getting gigs downtown and stuff. And nobody, people do, but you don't move here to play live shows in town. I mean, right. Clubs, right. At least I don't, not that, you're trying to do sessions or play on the road with the artist or something. Not, I guess, like Austin or something, make a living playing club, which plenty of people are doing now because Broadway is like ridiculous, but I don't.
Yeah.
It's just a different era.
I think though, from, I go down every once in a while, I have friends come into town like, Deb, let's go downtown. I'm like, oh Lord. But I do still think it's a training ground, right? Like a lot of people come here, they get to play every night, they're doing lots of songs, and that's one of the best ways to become a great musician, to be able to play every day with other players and learn new songs after new songs. So I do think that still exists. But what I do hear about downtown is that the way they get paid now is really sad. Like it used to be fun when we would play for tips, right?
Oh yeah.
But now I've heard stories where they're actually having to take money out of their tips to give to the clubs to play. So I feel really bad if that really is happening, because it's hard enough to survive years ago on tips, never mind what the state of the economy is in Nashville now. Like everything's so expensive to live here. And then if they are taking tips away like that, I give them a lot of credit if that's how they're having to make their money down there, because it's hard.
One of my favorite stories was Randy Coors when he'd played across the street and he'd, had a pretty good tip jar, and somebody came in and grabbed it and he chased him down Lower Broad and got it back.
Shot him. I can believe it.
Give me that back.
So, absolutely. But I guess I mean, as far as, coming here to, you want to make your living playing in Nashville. Yeah. I guess that happens.
Well, I think we didn't talk about the word of mouth aspect of, like, if you go do a lot of shifts on Lower Broadway and you're that good,
yeah,
people start talking about you and
absolutely
start hearing about auditions and, hey, we need somebody to come in, yeah, and do some demos, recording, and
go out on the road with somebody because they're
so
great.
Yeah, I mean, it's not totally an end all.
No, it's just
to move
different
to play in Lower Broadway, but it is a whole thing.
I think it's harder for them. I do, even just like to get to the show to do it.
Oh my gosh!
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, just the parking, mm-hmm, and how you have to bring, yeah, your gear in used to be hard as it was going through a crowd with all your gear. I can imagine what it must be like now for a musician to. It's a lot of work for them.
It is, and then you got to pay parking.
Yeah.
Yes.
On top of that.
So let's give a shout out and a cheer for all those musicians who've came to town working hard to get to their end dream. Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Plus, I park so far away because I don't want anybody to hit my car. So
one piece of gear we haven't talked about is a really good two-wheel car.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh.
Chaz is all over this.
Yes.
Wow.
Do tell, Chaz.
Oh, yeah. Just, you know, Lowe's, Home Depot, $25. Steel, made in the USA.
Little bungee cord.
You can get amp, pedal board, pedals, all kind of stuff on one and add extra years to your life.
I totally agree.
However, some guys don't mind at all grabbing an amp and a pedal board in one hand and lugging them, but
no, the wheels are good. The wheels are good.
Shazam! Oh, we're back.
We are back.
That was one of our best ones.
It was one of our best ones. Something has not escaped me today.
Yes,
you're wearing different clothes. It's shocking.
What are you trying to say?
I'm trying to say that you've worn the same vest every show.
My
it's
blue?
Clean, I guess, but
well,
different
that's
shirts.
A stretch. I know. Well, I always get so busy, I forget to pick out an outfit, and so I'm like, "Well, I'll just wear the vest because I like the vest." But I
thought
I hear
it smelled better in here. it's a candle.
Well, I decided because Andy was our guest and Chaz was coming back on that I would make a better impression with a different outfit. So.
Oh, yes.
But I did have to put like a Red Sox t-shirt on.
Very impressive.
Thank you.
So are we going to see the white jacket for the next five episodes?
Andy doesn't like the Red Sox. I forgot. Sorry.
Yeah, right.
I should have worn Yankees, but then I would be banned from Boston forever. We still have a lot of relatives that are like diehard Red Sox fans, and they'd be like, wait, what? So. Yes.
You both look fantastic, so thank you for wearing clean clothes.
You're welcome.
Yes,
you
thank
too,
you.
Chaz.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah.
Shazam!
Ooh.
Ooh!
Yes, it's a whirlwind.
Yes. Well, it was super fun having you here today.
Thank you. Fun being here again. I had such a good time the last time.
Yes,
and again today, and I really enjoyed uncovering the secrets to Andy's tone.
I have to
say that we could all go get the same gear, but it still won't sound as good.
True that.
It is true.
This is true. Dang I would it. Have to agree with that. Well, Chaz, as you remember from the last time,
checks in the mail.
Aww. We toasted with some yerbas. And this time, these are actually carbonated. But I wanted to share with Julie and Andy and you that I discovered something about the yerba mate.
Do tell.
Yes. So I've been all along calling these yerba mate, that was the brand, right. Yerba mate. So I'm in the Whole Foods store looking for my yerba mate, and I see this other. I'm like, oh, did they come out with a different kind? Look at that. Oh, look at all these yerba mates. And then I started noticing that the branding on the cans was different. And then it hit me. Yerba mate is not the brand. Yerba mate is a thing. It is a thing.
It's a plant.
It's a plant. And so the brand of this, I don't even know how to say guayaki or guki or gaki. I don't know what that is.
Guayaki?
Guayaki?
Guayaki.
So that's not as fun to say. I'm sorry.
Oh, it's way fun.
Does that mean we don't have to keep drinking these?
Well, we could actually start trying other kind of yerba mates, I guess, and then decide which one we like the best.
Yeah, I like that.
So a big, what do you call it?
Chicks with gear shout out.
Yeah, or chicks with gear faux pas.
So yerba mate is not the brand. Yerba mate's the plant.
Yes.
Okay.
So it's
organic. Guayaki is the brand.
Yeah. So it's almost like.
Have we been drinking the same kind?
Yes.
Okay. Guayaki.
Yeah.
Because we love you.
Yes. Yes. Guayaki.
I believe Guinness makes yerba mate. So we, just saying.
Just saying. All right.
Okay, well, here
so
we go.
Let's
cheers,
cheer them all up.
Fun.
To Chev coming on over here.
Oh, yeah.
Cheers.
Thanks so much.
To Andy sharing his secrets.
Thank you.
Yes.
Cheers. Oh, I think
she's going to say.
Oh, yeah.
Pass that to Andy.
All right.
From Julie.
All right. From
Abby. Ah.
Still tastes great, even though if it is called guayaki.
Quite refreshing.
It is refreshing.
Yeah, this is. I think this one's my favorite. It's the cranberry pomegranate.
Mm-hmm. Really good.
I like
it. Yes.
And I like it too.
Guayaki, guayaki, guayaki.
Let me try this again.
That's funny.
That's one of my favorite moments of all our episodes. I didn't even know you did it until I was editing it, and I was like laughing so hard. It was like midnight. I'm like, oh my gosh, I wanted to share with those guys. Like, this is so
That's funny.
Well, you're a good sport, Chaz.
Yes.
I can be a fool with the best of them.
You come to the right place.
Well, Chaz. This was awesome having you back today. And to watch you grill Andy a little bit was kind of fun, too.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. My pleasure. Enjoy it.
Yes.
Glad to find out some hidden secrets.
Yeah, yeah, right?
Thanks for having me.
Yes, it was nice having you as our guest, Andy. Yeah.
It sure was.
Privileged. Honored.
Well, that's all we have for today. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe below. And thank you so much for tuning in. And until next time,
don't you worry about it.